Fucking long. Make me say, ow! What's poppin', y'all? You're listening to the Nestorius Public Motherfucking Radio Show live on skidrowstudios.motherfucking.com. That's right, y'all. You haven't washed your underwear, you haven't flossed in a month, and your breath stink. And it's Thursday night, it's 9 p.m. You know where you at. 9 p.m., almost to 10 p.m., you're going to be with me with your boy for about an hour. If you're on the East Coast, get the fuck to sleep, man. Don't you got to get up in the morning for a job? Oh, I forgot. You ain't got a job. What's happening, man? Got my man Rich Corbin over here on the
What's up, everybody?
On the fuzzy mic.
I'm fucking hungry.
And to homeboy's right, as you know, a return guest from the best, don't stop, undress, motherfuckin's licking on the zip zap, you don't stop, Sal Rodriguez.
What up, listeners? Thanks for having me.
That's it. He's a very educated and proper Latino. Hey, we have a great show.
I'm not educated, no.
Yo, we have a great show. I'm really excited. I'm real excited today. We're going to have a serious discussion on the legalization of marijuana.
Woo!
Colorado being the first state to legalize marijuana for, anal consumption.
Because California was stupid two years ago.
Whatever, we'll talk about it. Whatever. Y'all know that, homeboy, I'm sober. I don't get high. But, you know, I like to give you some fruit to think about. You know what I'm saying? Fuck that, you bomba clad pussy clad man. Negro don't need to be smoking them herb to be bugging the fuck out.
Wait, how are you going to do a reggae accent without smoking the herb?
Check this out. I got enough THC in my motherfucking nutsack to last me for a lifetime.
For the record, you used to smoke weed.
Yeah, used to, a long time ago. But that's not what we're going to discuss here. We're going to discuss the pros and cons, all sorts of questions that people may not have thought about, taxation and all that other stuff. Anyway, we really have a really special guest that's going to be calling in live from Colorado, the free cannabis state. My boy, comedian Jeffrey Peterson, the 420 comic, who's also a pro cannabis activist, and my man knows everything and anything: how to wash it, how to backwash it, how to fucking double dribble with it, how to ingest it, how to smoke it, how to brush your teeth with it, how to fucking do news reports with it. My man knows. You want to know about cannabis? You talk to my man Jeffrey Peterson.
He's in Colorado right now.
My man Jeffrey.
Nice.
I'm gonna tell you something.
Did he relocate?
My man Jeffrey moves wherever the fucking potent smoke is at. That's where he lays his hat. This dude is diehard dedicated. That's why I love him. Yeah. He's not one of these fucking cockamamie ass cock swallowing, not to make a retarded analogy, but like, you know those sports fans that love the Yankees when the Yankees are winning, or the Dodgers when the Dodgers are winning? This dude, he's a lifer with this shit. So I'm very happy to have him. But before we go on with that stuff, I just wanted to two things happened. I wanted to give a big up to Russell Johnson. This was unexpected. But you remember Russell Johnson?
Right back in your hair,
So Russell Johnson, this 70s for all you young motherfuckers, you were still like spermatozoa particles in your fucking father. Actually, your mother and your father's when they were girlfriends and shit, because boyfriend and girlfriend, they weren't even born. But this is the 70s, and he was an actor who played Professor Roy Hinckley at the pretty popular show in the 70s, Gilligan's Island.
You know what pissed me off?
What?
Is when they had that alternative or alternate
ending?
Opening. No, they had the alternate opening credits where they would go, and the rest.
Right.
I hated that shit. You know, the real, it's supposed to be the Professor and Marianne. Instead they go, and the rest. I'm like, fuck you, Sherwood Schwartz.
You know why? Because he was smoking pot. He forgot the lyrics.
Sherwood Schwartz?
the whole motherfucking...
Big up to your fucking Sherwood Schwartz, your Jewish sitcom-created motherfucker!
Yeah. Well, big up, man. Big up, rest in peace of Russell Johnson. Big the fuck up, Russell Johnson! He was always trying to get the crew out of the... Trying to invent a way to get everybody out.
He invented all that shit.
Right.
How to power all that stuff.
Right. And then the next person that just, you know, kind of saddened me, Dave Madden, the actor, not the... There's a baseball player by the name
football
of,
guy,
football
right?
Football player. One of those. They play with balls, one of those guys.
Isn't that Steve Madden?
That's Steve Madden, right. Yeah, he's a shoe guy.
Dave... Yeah.
Steve Madden is a shoe guy.
Anyway, Steve Madden?
No, it's Dave Mattingly, I think it is. I'm confused. Anyway, as you know, it doesn't matter here on this story, it's public radio because no one's really listening.
We just lost all our football audience now.
I'm not going to get any emails telling them, you know, cross-checking my stuff, so don't worry about it. Just follow the thread, not the bouncing ball, okay? So Dave Madden, best known as the Sad Sack band manager in the 1970s TV show The Partridge Family, died today at the age of 82. So Madden played the character of Reuben Kincaid on the show about a family of musicians who travel around in an old school bus to perform. Ironically enough, he was often vexed by the antics of the Partridge Kids, led by David Cassidy and Danny Bonaducci. Yeah, so the reason I even mentioned him is because, let me give him a little big up there. Big up! Big up! You know it. Rest in peace.
Danny Bonaducci, who's done more drugs than probably everybody combined.
Danny Bonaducci.
He outlives Dave Madden.
Danny Bonaducci has been in more fucking rehabs and has fucking done more steps than Jeff Conway and the New World Trade Center, the fucking Freedom Tower, okay? So, and then the other dude, David Cassidy, Google him and you'll see how. Google him in the 70s and then Google him now and you'll be like, that's a perfect example for not doing drugs or alcohol if you can't handle it. You've seen a picture of him lately.
He's well, you're talking about Sean Cassidy's brother, right?
David Cassidy, dude, the fucking the lead of the Partridge Family.
Yeah.
I guess he's Sean Cassidy.
I think they're related.
Well, fuck Sean Cassidy. I'm talking about David Cassidy. Yes. Dude was like super sexy hunk in
sure,
the 70s.
He was a heartthrob, yeah.
Yeah, big time.
Now my older sister's had his poster on the wall, sure.
Right, she still does, right?
I think so. My older sister still does have fantasies about David Cassidy.
Anyway, the dude's fucked up. So that's one of the reasons why I wanted to just talk to them, you know, bring those guys up to the forefront, because we're going to be talking about... That's right.
Hands from a bong. That's my Be Real. Hands from a bong.
What are you talking about? Yeah. So, you know, basically, I'd love this. All right.
I remember once I saw Be Real and Carmen Electra coming out of the Sherman Oaks Fashion Square.
They were together for a long time. All right, so marijuana is legal in Colorado. It's actually going to be legal in Washington State by the end of February of this year.
Woo!
New York State, in addition to about 20 other fucking states, are going to legalize it for medicinal purposes. So there's a big fucking, you know, I believe 58% of Americans are pro cannabis, which is about 10% higher than it was in, you know, three or five years ago, yeah. Which is a big deal if you think about it. You mentioned 2 years ago California pussied out. That's a perfect example. All the other states are going to follow suit. But who's benefiting from this, right? Why such a big deal? Why such a big deal? I mean, people have been smoking marijuana for fucking centuries. The law hasn't stopped them and never did, right?
Yeah.
All right. So some questions to think about. Will the price go up if it's legal? How much taxes are being imposed on the sale? Where will the tax revenue go? Who's enforcing the regulations? At what cost? These are some of the questions that I'd like to ponder. Because, you know, yeah, you get high, right? A lot of people I know like to smoke a little bit of weed. Not everyone's a true diehard like my man J-Bone that's going to be calling a little while ago, lifestyle motherfuckers. You know what I mean? But so everyone is like, yeah, you know, legalize it for the main reason of you can just easily get it, buy it on, you know, buy it and not have to be criminalized by it. Yeah?
Yes.
So the main reason of pro marijuana people who are down for it is just that Let me just read this. The champions of marijuana's legislation have long argued that regulated sale of the drug would drive down production costs and retail price. The availability of cheaper legal cannabis would generate precious tax revenue and refocus drug enforcement efforts on more socially harmful narcotics such as cocaine, heroin, and crystal meth. Okay. There are about 750,000 marijuana arrests every year, nearly half of all drug arrests. Now, the cost to society of trying to police marijuana use and to individuals who get jailed for it are both wildly out of proportion. Then there's the racial discrimination issue. Blacks in the U.S. use and sell cannabis at the same rate as whites, okay, but are four times more likely to be arrested for it. Okay, so that's like the main, one of the main issues on the surface, right? That, so you legalize marijuana, you know, if you get caught buying it, right, you're not going to get jailed, you're not going to get arrested. If you get caught with, which announce you're allowed to buy in Colorado if you're a resident of Colorado. So if you get caught with an ounce or less, you're not going to get busted.
My
right?
mom, my mom's good. She lives in Colorado.
Your mom lives in Colorado?
Yeah, man. Well,
can we go crash on her couch for a weekend?
Sure, she's all about that. Nice.
Well, what's interesting is that none of this is cut and dry. None of it is black and white. There's a lot of ambiguities and vaguenesses, and
there's a lot of things that they had to. You know, they have to just, they have to throw it out there before they can, you know, they can't sit back and go, okay, well, it's going to be just like this.
No, no.
They got to work through all the rules and the laws and shit.
But the most important issue here is that just because it's legal in Colorado, right, and let's say Washington next and other states that legalize it, does not mean it's legal. Because the federal right. government, who mandates the jurisdiction, I just smoked a joint a little while ago, the jurisdiction of all of the United States really has the legal right to arrest
you. Yeah, they could go in and bust you in a second, which I never understood. Because,
anytime. Yeah. So federal law supersedes local law. So it's a little weird. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? It's almost like that DOMA situation that we were talking about last episode. You know
mm-hmm.
what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Where local governments do not recognize same-sex marriages, but under the Constitution, the federal government says that's not right.
Right.
So it's this whole fucking thing that, okay, so that's a major issue because...
Well, there's some areas in Colorado and some counties that in Colorado that won't sell it, and they won't have dispensaries in their county. They can refuse it.
Of course, just because it's legal doesn't mean you have to sell
right.
it. I mean, there's some articles...
They can vote it down.
There's some articles in Aspen where marijuana use has been like, you know, it's not a big fucking deal. Mm-hmm. So we get high, whatever. Here's the other thing. Just because it's legal doesn't mean you can smoke it anywhere. You still can't smoke it in public.
Right.
You can't just fucking buy an ounce of weed and say, fuck it. I'm going to go to the middle of the park and I'm going to.
Well, no, you.
Shit, man.
I'm hungry, man.
That's
yo.
Some good shit.
Mm.
There were some concerns, though. Did you read that part? What was it?
All right.
About them smoking on the ski slopes because it's in the middle of nowhere.
Well, that's another issue. We have a call on the line. Is that Jeffrey? Is Jeffrey, you on the line?
Yes, it is, man. You guys are cracking me up, man.
Yo, dude, what's up, baby? Hold on a second. I got to give you a prop. I got to give you a proper due. Hold on. I got to give you a proper due. Big the fuck up! Big up Jeffrey motherfucking Peterson, 420 for life, yo! What's up, baby? How you doing?
Dude, I'm living it. I'm living the recreational marijuana lifestyle.
Okay, guys, out there in Internetville, podcast land, Skid Row Studios, whores, fucking... iTunes. What you're listening to right now is the pure essence, the euphorial fucking vibration coming out of Jeffrey's fucking existence. He's fucking, his pores are fucking popping THC. His eyebrows are fucking infiltrating THC waveforms, okay? Could you hear it in his voice?
I like euphorial.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Yes. You cats have been around me, and you know... I've been euphorial in California. Here in Colorado, you guys, It's like snow on the ground, but Cali weather.
In Colorado?
It is. It's beautiful,
yeah.
Dude,
it's beautiful.
You know where they've delegated me to smoke legally? On the patio.
So you were telling me...
Go ahead, smoke on the patio.
Right, so you were telling me that within your lease, it is stipulated that you're allowed to get high on your patio.
That's where they told me to get high.
Wait, you're saying the landlord has issued an official statement as to where you're allowed to smoke pot in the building?
Well, you can get high in your own property. If the landlord owns that property and he's a pro-marijuana and he smokes pot or whatever, then he can say anybody who is a tenant of mine can smoke pot, and that's in your lease.
Yeah, but he can also do the opposite, where he can say you cannot smoke pot in my building. Is that correct?
Of course.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, here's the thing, too. You know, I love your guys' conjecture because you guys are so sweet. Here's the thing. Here's the beautiful thing about this is the lease was signed before marijuana was legal for recreational use.
That doesn't surprise me. Yeah, but that doesn't surprise me, Jeffrey. I mean, your landlord is a fucking diehard for life stoner, obviously. His life was not inconvenienced because it was illegal to get high. He got high. He lived it. He lived that way. He doesn't. You know what I'm saying?
Now wait a second, Jeffrey. Is the landlord or is your lease merely riding on the coattails of the tobacco smoking a portion of the lease? In other words, if the landlord said smoking on the patio means all smoking.
Nestor, I'm not going to fib with you, dude. I live in a very conservative area of Colorado.
Yeah.
Which makes it kind of a touchy situation. That's why.
So I'm hold on.
Where are you living? Cherry Creek?
So hold on.
Colorado.
Hold on. There's not one black guy in that neighborhood. That's what you're telling me?
Oh, then he's in Cherry Creek.
No, there is not.
Not one black guy of Colorado. Hold on. Not even one mulatto, like a Cocoa Puff looking motherfucker? Not one?
The only thing you would do here is like be a dishwasher. I mean, it's like there's no room here.
I got you, man.
They didn't even affirmative action somebody in there?
No. Dude, I even mentioned where I live in Parker, Colorado to people in Denver. They go, where the heck is that?
Right. You can say fuck if you want. It's all good.
Parker's nice. My uncle lived in Parker.
So let's get back to some of the questions that I had posed at the beginning of the show. But one question I want to ask, you actually sound more high than I've ever heard you. So my question to you is, my question to you is, because I'm armed with all sorts of fucking nuts and crannies and juicy tidbits of information and points of views. But so you don't need the law to be on your side to get high, Jeffrey. You're a fucking stoner, right?
I am.
Okay, so
I'm more than a stoner. You know this about me.
I'm more than a stoner.
I'm an advocate.
Yeah.
I'm an activist.
Yes, you are.
And I really believe in medical marijuana for the people. And this place, dude, Colorado is selling recreational marijuana. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, but hold on. Recreational marijuana and medicinal marijuana, two different things. I'm with you. I think if you need marijuana from a medicinal point of view, I get it. You know what I mean? But fucking... I'm not going to get into the politics of that.
Okay,
what I wanted to
let me just say this
go ahead.
To you, brother.
Go ahead, brother.
You know my brother Dan.
I do know brother myself. Dan. Listen to you, brother.
From the beginning, he and I have both felt that recreational marijuana is the only way to go, not medical marijuana, because medical marijuana is a joke.
Jeffrey, no, there are pros and cons to medical marijuana and medicinal marijuana versus recreational marijuana. We'll get into all those things. There are pros and cons.
Hey, let me say this.
Go ahead.
Every time I use marijuana, whether recreationally or not, it's still medicinal.
I got you. Even if you're not sick, it's beneficial. I got you, Jeffrey. I'm not gonna argue that point. Yeah, getting a little bottle of water. So you seem a little high. Is the marijuana a lot better? Is it more potent right now where you're at than what you're used to here in California at the dispensaries?
You know what? It's the freedom here makes you higher.
Got it.
And they're a mile above sea level, too.
Got it. Got it. So basically, you're riding on some of the buds and some of the euphoria of some sort of victory for your activism.
It's unbelievable. Yeah, it really is. You know what's weird is, as a comedian, I've been working the niche of pot comedy for 10 years now.
I can attest to that.
You know, George Lopez was one of the people that told me, be a pot comic.
Right.
And I come to Colorado, there's pot comedy, like, all over the state. And yeah. I love it.
Hey, would you mind if I played a two-minute clip from the first day of the opening of one of the pot retailers in Denver?
Not at all.
Okay, just stand by, okay? I just wanted to play this because I thought it was interesting. If I can fucking get this thing to work. Come on, you motherfucker. There we go. All right, is it happening? There we go. I'm gonna do a little fucking advertisement. It's anyway. So it'll just be a second or two here. But no, this is just like a little intro of news report of when the whole fucking thing came on. There we go. Fuck. Hold on. What is going on here?
I wanted to ask Jeffrey's opinion on
Ask Jeffrey.
Jeffrey, yeah. I wanted to ask your opinion. When someone recreationally smokes medicinal marijuana, what is there harm in that?
When somebody... What?
Never mind this shit. He's saying when somebody smokes medicinal marijuana recreationally, is there something wrong with that? He's trying to drop a motherfucking jiggle on you. You know what I'm saying?
That's hilarious. You know what the thing is? Every time I use it recreationally, it's medicinal. Every time.
You have a whole crew of people back there engaging in your humor, huh?
No, I just have my sexy girlfriend.
Your sexy girlfriend. You know what? I'm not gonna play this fucking video. Fuck you. This is these stupid fucking videos on some of these websites are like, you try to like line them up to bypass the fucking ads, and then you have them on pause, and then they just fucking freeze up on you. You know what, Jeffrey? So let me just continue with some of the stuff. So medicinal. Here's one of the things from an objective non marijuana guy, right? So. Medicinal marijuana, well, here's the deal. So 15%, authorities have levied a 15% wholesale and a 10% retail tax on marijuana transactions, right? The price of legal commercial grade pot has doubled to $400 an ounce since the start of the year, right? Now, I read, and this is from Aaron Smith, executive director of the National Cannabis Industry Association, right? So I read in another article that an eighth was going for $65 for an eighth of an ounce, which if you do the math, that's $520 an ounce, okay? So basically what the article was saying that that's twice the price for medical marijuana at a state dispensary that require a doctor's prescription, right? On the black market, high-grade offerings are fetching $156 to $250 an ounce, according to data compiled by Narcotic News. Okay, so why would I want to buy $520 worth for an ounce just because it's legal? I'm a street kid, you know what I'm saying? I just assume...
You wouldn't, bro, because... A guy like you is a guy like me. You'd still buy from a dealer.
Right. So then what's the fucking... thank you. So my point is, this whole big hoopla about legalization of marijuana, really, my whole stance here is not to pro or con it, but just to ask the question, who's really benefiting from it, though, Jeffrey? Because...
Hey, you know, let me tell you this.
Yeah.
The beauty of all this is the bottom line. And the bottom line is this. A cop doesn't know whether I bought my weed from a dealer or a dispensary.
Right. Okay. That's interesting.
The thing is, I don't have to now worry. Like, what am I supposed to do with paranoia? It's gone.
Got it.
I used to have paranoia.
That's an interesting
thing. Hey, man, and you can grow up to 6 plants now, too.
Yeah, well, that's per person.
Exactly.
I'm going to tell you something right
now,
Jeffrey.
That's great.
If I can't get high and be paranoid, I don't want to get high. That's part of my fucking experience.
Yes, because you know why? Because cartoons are still interesting.
No, but you know, seriously.
Yeah, you do.
Seriously.
You definitely want to still get high. Thing is, what do we do with paranoia? It's like, now I have to look at a cop and go, hey, how you doing?
Now you don't have to.
Nice to meet you, man. We got to be friends now.
This is
weird.
Right. Well, this is what I love about you, because you have a different perspective on it. I didn't see that perspective. Okay, so now it's legal. So the stigma of being arrested for being high or carrying an ounce without a card, it's no longer there. And it doesn't matter who you...
Now I got to offer a cop fries, dude. Now I got to go, hey, you want some French fries, bro?
Right. Oh my god, this is from a guy that we're in Los Angeles, right? Everyone fucking drives, right? My man Jeffrey's the only dude I know that rocks a motherfucking two beach bike. He's rocking a motherfucking beach bike, like, without the bell. Ricking, ricking, without the bell. Homeboy's like, yo, what's up, baby? How you doing?
Let me tell you, Nestor.
Yeah.
I used to drive, bro.
I know.
And when I did drive, I got pulled over in La Cañada.
Yeah.
And a cop literally, when I got pulled over, asked me if he could have a bite of my fries. This really happened.
This motherfucker.
That's because he had the munchies, man.
Going tonight? I go, I'm going up to, to Hunga. And he goes, you got French fries? I go, yeah. And he goes, let me take a bite of them. I said, no problem.
So, Jeffrey, listen. So you gave me the angle as to why it's advantageous for it to be legal, whether or not you participate in the retailers in Colorado, because you got just your dealers, so it doesn't really fucking matter. But let's look at the retailers, right? From their perspective, people all of a sudden think, okay, well, I have money, I'll start growing marijuana, and I'll start selling it because I get high. Also, it's a business. It's big business, right? So,
yes, sir. Let's get real. It made $5 million
right.
In 5 days.
Right.
That's unbelievable.
That's unbelievable.
Better than a movie studio.
But check this out. If I wanted to raise $5 million to fucking educate everybody on one day in America in one shot, I guarantee you I wouldn't get 5 cents.
You wouldn't. Because you know why? Because they're not pot smokers.
Right, right. But
pot
here's...
smokers. This is where it's at, dude.
But here's the oxymoron. Here's the oxymoron of that. Here's the oxymoron. That most of the money, 30% of the tax dollars that are being collected, supposedly will go to schools, right? There's the oxymoron. What fucking stoner do you know is in school?
Hey, can I tell you this?
Nestor, I thought you're not supposed to be pro or con. That sounded like a big fat con.
Hey, I hate to burst your bubble.
Be the fuck up, Tom, you marijuana smoking, school dropping motherfucker! Go ahead, burst my bubble.
Let me burst your bubble, bro.
Yeah.
We don't care whether it helps anyone. All we care about is that we can smoke marijuana without a cop fucking with us.
I got you.
That's
I got
all we
you.
Care about.
I got you. That's truthful.
That is all we care about.
That's truthful. Because I get it. And I totally get it. I totally get that perspective. And you know what?
We know that the rest of square society doesn't know is that our crops from cannabis can save the entire United States deficit. We know that.
Well,
so we're going to go ahead.
This is where I was getting to. So retailers, yeah. This is what I'm getting to. So I'm getting on to the other side, the business side of it, right? So in order for the sale of your crops to benefit the deficit and the money, you have to sell and you have to tax it, right? That's the only way you're going to do it, right? So on one hand, one of the arguments is that, well, you won't. The statistics was in a 2010 study by the Libertarian Cato Institute forecast the states could save $17.4 billion annually from reduced drug enforcement costs and increased tax revenue, assuming marijuana production and sales were legal nationwide, which is what you're saying, right?
You opened up a can of worms.
But hold on. Refill the bong.
The can of worms you just opened is like, what are the cops going to do without the money that they demand each year for law enforcement?
This is one part.
Jail for a plant.
Well, this is one part of the argument, Jeffrey. This is one part of the argument. This is one part of my questioning, right? So $17.4 billion. Okay, so now you don't have police that need to enforce the law because now it's not against the law. All right, fine. But then let me ask you this. Who is going to be hired to enforce the regulations of the 70-30 rule, right? Where every retailer has to grow at least 70% of the crop that they're selling. They can only buy 30%.
Let me ask you this, Nestor, realistically. Let's get real.
Yeah.
Let's get totally real. Does somebody go buy a florist or a nursery to make sure that they're selling their product up to the standards of the U.S.,
Department of Agriculture?
This is ridiculous.
No.
This is not realistic.
I know what
the fact that the FBI has not been able to enforce this on a federal level. They're not going to be able to enforce it now.
So you're basically saying, hold on. So you're basically saying, well, it's not going to matter anyway because they're not going to be able to enforce it. But here's the thing, Jeffrey. Monies, right? Those supposed taxes, 25% plus local taxes that are being imposed on growing the marijuana and selling it, right? That money is supposed to go towards, revenue for local governments, for schools, or whatever the hell they do. But what's going to happen is they're going to spend all that money on bullshit because they don't even know what they're looking for, which is what my perspective was.
It's going to be like the lottery. Remember the California lottery was supposed to save the schools and didn't do jack shit.
Right.
It just gave them some place to take the money from the schools again.
No, I know, Jeffrey, but you can't just take the stance of, I mean, you can, but it's not fair as an advocate to just take the stance of I don't give a shit what happens in the big picture.
You know what the thing is, Nestor?
Yeah.
This untruth will be proved to be an untruth like everything else.
Right.
It is a fallacy and it will be proved to be such. So the thing is, the cannabis advocates believe right. that this is a victory, and it really is. I mean,
it is.
Colorado.
No, listen.
Even existed this long with recreational marijuana.
It is a victory. It is a victory, but you have to look at the bigger picture, Jeffrey. You can't just look at it from the perspective of it's a victory. We don't care about the big picture. We just care about the police not arresting us. You have to look at the big picture because the only reason that some of these local governments are like allowing this shit to happen is a taxation experiment. Okay.
Hey, look at this, dude. California has so much more to benefit than Colorado.
Right. With taxes. Yeah.
The fact that California hasn't done this is absurd.
No, it's not absurd. California is fucking inundated with super and ultra conservatives, okay? So a lot of their decisions and their political decisions are made and based on religious beliefs, Okay? So whereas Coloradians, their religious beliefs are based on ski slopes, Californians are based on property and religious beliefs, i.e. fear. Okay?
So let me tell you, I got to step in and say that Coloradans have taken the California model and benefited from it so much that they are proving the model that this is going to be the wave of the future.
Well, I'm going to have to agree with you on that because I grew up in Colorado.
Well, Jeffrey, you're absolutely right. This is the wave of the future. This is why I'm posing these questions right now. This is the wave of the future. I mean, as you know, you posted New Hampshire just voted in favor of the legalization of, I believe you said recreational use, right?
Medical.
Not
medical, recreational.
They're proposing it
for a big event, and these people are so compassionate about this issue, man.
No, I get
Americans
you.
Americans are gonna take over.
No, I get you. Washington at the end of February. New York, fucking Andrew Cuomo. New York is passing probably by June medicinal use in New York. It's happening. It's crazy. It's big. Whatever, whatever. But you know, there are also. I don't want any side effects, but there are also ramifications that come with this. You know, when you look at a metropolis like Los Angeles, where you're driving, 99% of the things you got to do, you have to be in a car. Not like New York, where you walk or you get in a bus or you get on a train or a cab. In L.A., you got to drive. And I'm sorry. Marijuana, if you're really smoking some good shit, you ain't fucking going to be paying attention to fucking road signs, cars, and
Jeffrey, can you back me up on this?
There's just going to be a lot of people missing their stops on the subway.
There's been no scientific studies that proves that marijuana smoking impairs an adult driving.
There is no?
No, there isn't.
Well, you're wrong.
There isn't.
You're wrong.
Dude, I've driven high. My shit was impaired, motherfucker.
Jeffrey, am I wrong?
No, you are not wrong. Dude, and the evidence is there.
Jeffrey!
I've got my own evidence.
Come on, bro.
Jeffrey, you're fucking... Let me tell you something.
Then why smoke pot if it doesn't impair you? Shit.
Yeah, you're bugging the fuck out.
Don't throw out that I ride in a subway, dude, because I can
assure
you.
No. Okay. I'm being honest.
I ride the 405 for a living.
I'm being honest. Marijuana not only impairs your fucking alertness, but it distracts. The distractibility when you're high is insane.
I wholeheartedly disagree.
Okay.
I think we make better people in traffic because we listen to the radio more and we chill. We don't even give a crap.
Yeah, you motherfuckers are causing the traffic.
Hits from the bong. Hits from the bong. Hi.
Hits from the bong. Yo, Jeff. Yo, Jeffrey. So listen. I'm gonna continue the show. Thank you so much for calling in, dude. You're my man. I'm very happy for you and your. You're pro marijuana activists, people, you know, fight the power. You know what I'm saying? I'm serious. I'm happy for you guys. I was always a supporter before this was even an idea. I thought, what's the fucking big deal?
Man.
People get high. Let them get fucking high. Tax them. But there are two sides to the issue. And, you know, right now, you marijuana motherfuckers are just basking in the glory of your victory. You can't really have a conversation about the pros and cons and the other sides. You know what I mean?
It's pretty difficult.
It really is. I got you.
We are loving it.
So right now, I just want to say, you know, big the fuck up. Big up your boom baclad pot smoking gurgling motherfucker. Big up your two-time waxing smoking sniffing pinching herbologist motherfucker. Big up your Buddha bless rolling sensimilian kush eating hashish browning popping motherfucker. All right, baby.
Thank you guys, man.
Thank you so much.
You
I love you too.
Thanks,
man.
Jeffrey.
Bye.
Okay.
I don't think, I bet you that Jeffrey has never had an outro like that.
Well, I got to tell you something. I got to tell you, no bullshit. I love Jeffrey. Joffrey's one of my favorite people, not because I just love him. He's got a good soul. He's a funny dude, very, very talented, highly intelligent. I mean, he's fucking burnt right now. He's fucking crisp. He's like,
how do you say, you know, how do you sit there and say he's fucking double dip high? What does that mean? How does somebody sound high?
What do you mean, how does somebody sound high?
Yo,
I'm high most of the time I see Nestor. He never knows it.
That's because that's how you always are.
You think I don't know it. I fucking know.
So you're saying that I sound high.
If you are sober, I can see the glaze in your fucking eyes, and I can see your demeanor is a little lackadaisical. I know when you're fucking high. Dude, look at me. I'm fucking 23 years sober. What do you think that means? That means I had my first blackout when I was 12. My first fucking inhalation of marijuana fumes when I was like 12 and a half. Okay? I got thrown out of my first pizzeria for fucking being loud and laughing too much after smoking pot at the age of 13.
That I believe.
Well, I'm just saying, dude. I know. Let me tell you something. There's a lot of things, and we can't go on too long, but I wanted to hit a couple of points. You know, Jeffrey makes a valid point. He says he don't give a shit. They don't care because right now they're just basking in the victory of it, right? But the truth of the matter is, in order for something like this to continue and to be, you know, effective, the local governments, it's going to have to be financially fruitful for them. They're going to have to make their money. You understand what I'm saying?
He's standing on his civil liberties. He's saying, right. I have a right to smoke.
Right.
And wait a second. Why is that not the same argument as a woman who says, I want to have an abortion. It's my body. I have the right to have an abortion if I'm a woman. I have a right to smoke. In other words, it's your right as a human being to smoke pot.
Yes.
What's wrong with that as an argument?
Nothing. Nothing. No one's arguing that. I'm just bringing in other thoughts that pertain to this whole ideology of legalization of marijuana, i.e. taxes, regulation. Let me tell you something. The amount of money that's going to have to go into training people to be able to go into a dispensary and say 30% of this marijuana was grown, 70% was grown, 30% was purchased. I am telling you that in order for this thing to work, it's got to be financially viable for the governments. When they say, yeah, we're collecting 17 point something billion dollars a year, then they're going to be like, this is working. These guys are getting high. There's no violence. There's no accidents. No problem, right? But there are things to think about. Let me give you an example. The local, the basic business model says that you have an FEIN number, right? A taxpayer ID as a corporation, right? With that FEIN number, you can go to a bank and open up a bank account, right? So with that bank account, that allows you to deposit money, write checks, pay your employees, get credit cards to pay for your product that you're selling. With the marijuana business, no go. It's a cash business. Okay? You can't have a traditional fucking bank account, and you can't fucking... So if you don't have a traditional bank account, how are you paying your employees if you're not paying them for cash, right? This is how it is now.
How do you do your taxes? How do you file your write-offs?
And they cannot write off.
They can't write off
basic business expenses. Yeah. They cannot. Because the other thing is that it's a federal offense. You understand?
They haven't been able to.
So banks are regulated by the federal government. So the whole thing is fucked up.
The banks are worried that they're going to be charged with laundering if they take money from...
large sums of money. Mm-hmm. So think about it. So now you're selling $5 million of Kush, of fucking, you know, Snap, Crackle, Pop, Purple fucking Bud, whatever the fuck you're selling, right? So you're selling $5 million. That's in cash. Okay, what do you think happens when motherfuckers think, wow, that retailer there is carrying on average $100,000 because where are they putting their money? In a safe? Where are they depositing it? You know what I'm saying? What if you're a criminal, what would you be thinking of?
The dispensaries in Los Angeles have armed guards at all of them.
Right. That's dispensaries.
I suppose they're all called dispensaries. Even the recreational places in Colorado are called dispensaries. And I object to that term.
And by the way,
I don't think Rite Aid and Walgreens are called pill dispensaries.
Well, by the way, they're not armed guards, all of them. They're security guards, and a lot of them are fucking high valet fucking attendants.
They look armed when I drive by there.
No, I got an idea. Why don't they just fucking deal in bitcoins?
Well,
PayPal. How about if you're a retailer selling me pot, I pay you via PayPal.
But then, then you need an FEIN number. If you have a business and you're fucking collecting funds via PayPal, PayPal has to... You have to be. You have to have a business.
Yeah, but they have to pay taxes. These guys have to pay taxes.
This is what I'm saying. This is what I'm saying. So you're saying you're going to collect. You're going to save the government 17 point something billion dollars. I say cock. Because what's going to happen is you're going to have to spend a lot of money in trial and error. How do you get money? How do you get your tax revenue?
They're gonna get their money. And the only reason why this has actually gone off the ground is because people are going to make money off of this. That's the only way that the politicians would have let this pass. Okay?
Right, no.
They're going to make a shit ton of money, and that was really the only excuse that they had, because you know what? The government, local, federal, whatever, they don't give a fuck about your rights to smoke
pot. Right.
They don't, no, really, they don't care about all that.
But so how are they going to make the money?
They're going to make the money by taxing at 25%.
How are they going to collect their money when it's all cash? How are they going to
Well, obviously it's happening.
They're collecting their money.
It's happening right now. You say how,
the
but
government
it's
is going to get their money.
Well,
they don't care
way.
If it's legal or illegal. They
put
do enough
way.
Illegal shit.
Put it this
they're going to get their money.
Put it this way.
Are they not? Are the taxes not being taken out from the dispensaries?
The dispensaries are different. I believe the dispensaries, since they're regulated, they have a traditional business model. So I believe that they can have checks to pay their employees and all
that
stuff.
Well, the medical dispensaries.
Right. But let me bring another element to it. I'm a homeowner. I go to a neighbor to watch meeting every, whatever, 2 or 3 months. And the local detective there that runs the thing, he says that the biggest form of crime is burglary. Like breaking into your car and stuff like that. Well, who do you think does that? Not the people who work at the dispensary, but the people who are, you know, low-level drug addicts that are rolling around that know people who are driving to get marijuana at dispensaries. So they break into cars. So it just creates...
Wait, are you saying that people are breaking into cars at dispensaries?
Not necessarily at dispensaries.
Or the people who go to dispensaries are breaking into cars.
No. I'm saying people around that hang around where a lot of dispensaries are. And you got to admit... In the Studio City, in the Valley, there's a fucking dispensary. There's more dispensaries per block than there are McDonald's and Starbucks. And there are a lot of those fucks, okay? Mm-hmm. So all I'm saying is that it's not cut and dry. It's not cut and dry. You know?
No, it is cut and dry because there's no reason why marijuana should not be under the same guidelines as broccoli and lettuce. It's a damn vegetable.
When I'm saying it's not cut and dry,
our society, our states... Our federal government
you're debating,
is too full of shit.
You're debating,
that's what it is.
We're not debating that. We know that. Well, you're arguing the civil rights point. We're past that. I'm not.
But you want to talk about taxation? That's all over the news. Of course,
you don't want to have
it.
You don't want to have individual rights. Okay.
What I'm trying to tell you is that it's not that simple to tax it. Yes, the government is going to get their bare minimum, absolutely. But are they going to get 100% of it? No, they're not. And then when the government starts finding out that they're not, it's going to be. What I'm trying to say is there's going to be more money spent on enforcing and regulating the fucking when it becomes. Legal to do all this stuff, not as much and probably nowhere near when you have to pay law enforcement to enforce the law against, you know, people who are violating marijuana laws, buying them illegally, right?
Yeah, you're talking about the cost of regulation versus the cost of criminalization.
Right, exactly. So I'm just saying, it's just a thing. So then the other issue is drug driving. Okay, so you say you can't tell. So here's a big problem. Here's a big issue. So with a single blow into a breathalyzer, law enforcement can determine if a suspected drunk driver is legally allowed to be behind the wheel, right? Because there's a limit. There's a number, right?
Yeah.
And there's a technology for it, right?
0.08 in California.
Right. But when it comes to driving under the influence of drugs, prescriptions, or illegal narcotics, it's not that simple. And unlike the 0.08 limit defined by the law in California is legally intoxicated to drive, there's no law defining the level of impairment allowable for drivers under the influence of drugs. That makes identifying and convicting drivers impaired by drugs a challenge for both police and prosecutors. Now, this is very important because what's going to happen is this will affect the community and taxpayers as a whole. Okay? When you have people that are fucking high and they're technically and legally, they're not drunk. They're getting away with shit. I was looking at what the drunk driving laws are in California. I think you have to pay your first offense. You have to pay like $300 to $1,000 and then 90 days in jail or something like that. Anyway, your fourth. Every single offense is the same. $300 to $1,000. That's your financial offense that you have to pay. And then the amount of time you do in jail goes from 3 months to 6 months to 9 months. You know what I mean?
For drunk driving?
Yeah, look it up.
No, nobody does any time for drunk driving.
Yeah, they do.
No, they don't. Everybody I know that's been busted for drunk driving pays a shitload of money to the courts and doesn't do any jail time.
Well, I was looking it up. Maybe I'm looking at a different jurisdiction. But what I'm saying is this will cost the taxpayers one way or another. We're going to have to, I mean, you cannot have people getting high. I'm not talking about just marijuana. I'm talking about drug driving. I'm talking about prescription. This is a big issue. Okay?
Yeah, dude, my neighbor got busted because he took some kind of like Vicodin or Percocet or something. And fucking, he was driving to church Sunday morning and he popped that. And he was so tired, he fell asleep, hit a car. And because that was in his system, he got a DUI.
And how much time did he have to do?
He didn't do any time.
Right.
Jesse, nobody does time for drugs.
He didn't do time.
But that's not true.
Unless you're destitute. If you're destitute and have no money, maybe.
Listen, they put him in the tank until he's sobered up, and then, you know.
No. It depends on what you do. If you kill somebody, that's a criminal offense then.
Yeah.
That's a different story. We're not talking about getting pulled over for DUI. You're talking about hitting somebody.
Well.
Personally, I know three people that have been busted for DUI arrested.
Right.
No jail time. Right. Maybe 24 hours, you know, but that's it.
Well,
no
jail time. They can't release you until you sober up.
Yeah, they paid like thousands of dollars, though.
No, it's a big
money maker for the courts.
You're gonna pay about $10,000.
But you have to do time. I mean, I was reading it. Maybe it's not in California.
Maybe another state. Maybe it's in other jurisdictions. That's possible, I suppose.
Look, this isn't my opinion about the whole driving and smoking pot. Look, it's legal, fine, but you got to take some responsibility for it.
Oh shit!
You couldn't. No, seriously.
Oh,
you couldn't
shit.
Fucking. You can't. No, you can't fucking smoke pot and I can drive fucking high. You know what? You're fucking altered. Your ability to operate machinery and all of that is impaired.
You're impaired.
I don't care what you say. Well, I've been high. I can't operate machinery. I can barely operate the remote fucking control. Okay?
I can barely.
You may have an allergy to pot that I don't have.
An allergy to pot?
Yeah, because I can smoke pot and drive all over the damn city. I've driven to San Francisco, to Arizona, to New Mexico, high the whole fucking time.
That's great. You know what? A lot of drunk people do that too.
Motherfucker, you can't even answer a text when you're high.
Listen, if you're gonna smoke pot and if whatever the powers that be deem it illegal to drive while you're fucking high, okay, until they have, you know, some kind of concrete evidence.
Which is now,
Either way,
it's illegal to drive high right now.
Okay,
right. Yeah.
Because they don't know if you can prove. Right. But here's the thing: they can do tests, they can run tests, and you read the fucking article.
They don't have the advanced and accurate technology for all this.
That's at the responsibility of the person smoking pot. Until technology comes up with them,
if that person harms other people, then it's at the responsibility and cost of everybody else around them, like anything else in this country. So then your insurance rates will go up because fucking retards can't afford their insurance.
I understand that, but it's a law and a rule. A law might actually stop people now that it's legal, and then there are some severe ramifications for driving while you're high, rather than now. You don't hear too much about it, but if they really start having to crack down on that, then you're going to second guess yourself. Maybe I shouldn't drive while I'm high. You know, I mean, look, you smoke pot every day. That's great. You can operate heavy machinery. You could probably fly an aircraft with being fucking
that's
high.
Sal.
But a lot of
Sal.
Fucking people can't because
Sal.
They
individuals. You're talking about individuals versus the whole. I can't drink alcohol and fuck. I go impotent. But
Sal.
That doesn't have the same.
Sal can fly
the same
a plane.
Thing
exactly. But Sal, they don't have a test that says you can drive. You know, there's a lot of people that can drive. Okay, there's a lot of people that can drive drunk very good, very well. They're good drunk drivers.
Yeah.
You might be a good pot driver,
right?
But
Too bad.
Okay, where are all the pot accidents? Where are all the pot deaths on the road? They don't exist.
You know where the pot accidents are?
I think they do.
No, they don't.
Where are they? Show me. There's the internet in front of you.
You're telling me that it doesn't exist?
I'm telling you to show me the accidents. They're not there.
I bet you they are.
Do you know where the accidents are? They're around the people who are driving under the influence of marijuana because they're causing accidents. They're stopping deaths.
There's no evidence of this whatsoever.
I drive in L.A. I see it all the time. There's no evidence of this.
People are texting. That's what they're doing. They're not smoking pot.
They're not paying attention.
You don't know if they're fucking high or not.
Who would text while they're driving?
No, you don't. You don't know who's high out there on the road.
So if you have this unknown, if you have this substance in your body that it's not known whether or not it can cause impairment.
Wrap it up in about 30 seconds.
Impairment. Then maybe we shouldn't take a chance yet. Okay.
No, maybe we should do some scientific studies. Isn't our society based on science?
I'm sure they have.
Do some scientific studies to prove this, which it has not done.
Okay.
Now we get into the nut of this.
You guys.
Yeah!
Okay, this is going to conclude the debate here because it's a fucking never-ending debate. The point of this whole thing is that really no one really knows what the benefits or the detriments are to the legalization of marijuana. For now, there are benefits to those who are diehard marijuana smokers like Jeffrey so that they can walk around with an ounce of weed and say, "Would you like some fries?" to the police officer. Right. For the rest of us, we have to sit back and find out what's going to happen. What is it going to cost you as a tax-paying citizen? What is it going to cost you as a civilian of, you know, your local city? Is it going to affect you? Is it going to affect your insurance rates? Are people going to get hit? Chances are they're not. But we don't know what the overall pluses and minuses are. For now, one thing I can tell you is that you still can't smoke marijuana in public. It's still a federal offense. So if you get caught by anybody in the federal government, you are a criminal. It doesn't matter.
And I do not smoke marijuana, for the record.
Right. That whatever you do, and
I think you added yourself
and you can,
a little
and
while
you can
ago.
Only just buy a certain amount. You can't just be fucking carrying pounds. Anyway, with that said, this is going to conclude this episode of Nestorius Public Radio. So make sure you tune in live every Thursday night, 9 to 10 p.m. Pacific Standard Time here on SkidRowStudios.com. Make sure you go to iTunes. Make sure you tell your homeboys, you know, while you're getting high, while you're rolling blunts, tell them to go to iTunes and look up Nestorius Public Radio and subscribe to my show. Also, hook us up on Facebook, facebook.com, Nestorius Public Radio, and follow me on Twitter. Why? I don't know why, but just follow me on Twitter at Nestorius NYC. Yes, Sal.
I was going to say, I invite all of your listeners to attend the show that I am hosting, comedy show, Third Street Comedy, Friday, January 24th, 9 p.m., Saturday, January 25th, 9 p.m., Third Street Comedy at the Promenade Playhouse, Santa Monica and Third Street.
Talking shit. So y'all gotta, like, you know, encourage me the whole way long. Ow. I ain't doing nothing but talking shit.